good.
Okay.
Where, I want to say good evening to everyone, and just so thankful and happy that you've made your way to Eastern Star Missionary Baptist Church's Bible study. I'm thankful for our committed viewers that I know are out there, even though I can't see you. I'm just thankful in advance to what you continue to do week after week and all of the positive feedback we get from having these crucial conversations. Tonight is our third night in a series of crucial conversations, and I have a local pastor with me today. Pastor Ben Kane is the pastor of Howard Memorial Presbyterian Church right down the street. He has agreed to come with us and share in this experience. We're thankful that he's taken time out of his schedule to be with us tonight, and we want to make sure that this time is productive and prosperous, Ben, and we're so glad to have you with us tonight. But like always, we're going to begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for this opportunity of sharing. We thank you for this opportunity that you have so graciously provided for us. We thank you for this platform. We thank you for those that are viewing now, and those that may view this broadcast later on. We pray that you would continue to hallow, consecrate, and sanctify the time that we have together. We pray that someone that is watching tonight may get some insight in the discussion tonight. Maybe it's just one thing that they glean from tonight's discussion, but we ask that you would just lead Ben and I in this conversation tonight. Lord, we're gonna be led by the Spirit tonight, and pray that you would just do in us that which you would have to be done. We thank you in advance for everything you've already done and the things that you're doing in the midst of us tonight. We bless you, we honor you, and we praise you in advance. For it's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, Ben, let's just jump right in. You are here in the hot seat. I didn't want to tell you that before before the broadcast got going, but I appreciate you coming and sharing with us tonight. And I'd like you just to introduce yourself, Ben, and let our viewers know a little bit about yourself.
So I'm Ben Cain. I'm the pastor at Howard Memorial Presbyterian Church, which is literally just down the road. Across Panola Street, and Kelly and I were talking. I've been there for 6 years, moved in May of 2014, and when I moved here, it was my wife Lydia and our 18-month-old daughter Margot, and since then we have had another daughter Phoebe, and Margot will be 8 in September, and Phoebe's 5,
awesome.
And so to be honest with you, I'm just glad to be here with you,
yeah.
To talk about what we're going to talk about, and to in the midst of a pandemic, to have this conversation, which needs to happen even if it wasn't a pandemic, but I'm grateful for the invitation.
Well, I'm glad you're here, Ben. And I think this is my first opportunity in the Crucial Conversations to talk to a guest from a pastoral perspective.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously, I think leadership is necessary in the times that we're in. And I wanted to kind of begin, I guess, our conversation, Ben, because I really believe that relationships are formed initially from establishing some common ground.
Yep.
And maybe tonight, our viewers may not know that Eastern Star and Howard Memorial has some common ground. And
right.
Would you kind of share some of that common ground that we have as churches first, and then we'll move on from there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the common ground that Kelly is referencing is actually, I always look back because it's the picture that's above my desk in my office, and it is our old church. So we were born in 1874, and then for over 20 years we had the same building, and then Eastern Star was interested in a new building, and we were as well. And the story I've heard, and I don't know if this is true, but I'm going to go with it because it sounds really good, is that the church was taken down board by board, and then pulled by mules on old, what I think are telephone poles, but they didn't exist at that point, and rolled into East Harbor, and then rebuilt, and the church was rebuilt. So we have literally shared the same building in two locations over the course of, you said 114 years, is the way, as long as folks have been here. So our churches have this very strong relationship physically. And now I think this is a relationship that is on a person-to-person level, pastor-to-pastor level, that I want to dig into and make grow and flourish. So
for sure. And Ben, again, like you said, from a historical standpoint, our churches are forever linked.
Right.
So we'll always have that in common. But I guess the reality is you and I over your 6 years have had some interactions, yep. And, you know, not as much as I'd like us to, but the reality is members from Howard have been here,
yep.
And, you know, we've had, you know, fellowship at Howard over the years as well.
Yep.
So hopefully this begins a precedent where we are able to do more intentional things together as
right.
well.
Right.
Why is that something like that important, Ben, for us, you know, to have cultural differences, but yet, you know, we've got Christ in common, of course, but how do we begin to bridge that gap between the blacks and whites? I mean, the reality is that's a tremendous issue, race is tremendous. And I know it's touchy for a lot of people, Ben,
right.
But the reality is we have to model what an example looks like of how you can have rich, productive conversation without, you know, it getting to a point where it's not productive.
Right.
Yeah.
So Kelly is referencing our confirmation experience where the kids in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade learn about making their own commitment to the church beyond their parents who bring them for baptism or their grandparents and whatnot. And so one of the things, a part of the confirmation experience, is to experience worship in a different way. While I think Howard Memorial's worship is amazing and wonderful,
sure.
It is not the only way to worship God.
Right.
And an opportunity, literally, like we said, right down the road, for our kids and our youth advisors to experience worship in a way that's very different. And then they come back from it, and they say it was slightly different, but at the same token, there were still prayers, there was still a sermon, and the people may have looked different, but it was still worship, and they were really nice to us.
Wow.
And so when you start to bridge those small gaps, and you talked about it, relationships build on this common ground, And the reality is that you worship on Sunday mornings. We worship, well, right now we worship in kind of different way.
That's for sure.
But you worship on Sunday mornings in a traditional non-pandemic experience. And we worship on Sunday mornings. And like you said, we worship the same God. And we experience the same God in very different ways. And for us, what we find is the young people feel like their experience is rich in, it enriches their understanding of who God is. Yeah. That God is not the God of just the white church. Mm-hmm. That we are more, this is the way we've always understood it. But that God is here as well, and is experienced in a totally different way.
For sure.
And when you see that, and when you feel that, there's something on which you can build, mm-hmm. like you said.
Yeah.
Which is what I want. And not to mention, I had the opportunity to preach, it feels like 5 years ago, but it was MLK weekend this year, 2020,
yeah.
To preach in your pulpit and to feel what it was like for you on Sunday mornings. And so again, another bridge that is happening in our own town, which is incredibly important. As you pointed out, race is a touchy subject, whether it's, you know, 1861 or it's 2020. Mm-hmm. But if we don't have the conversations, then we just keep sweeping it under the rug, and nothing good. You got to clean up at some point. You can't.
Right,
you cannot keep sweeping.
Right.
And my hope is that what we're doing tonight gives people the courage to have their own conversations, mm-hmm. and to begin to grow from this. So,
yeah.
Again, that's why I'm super excited to be here.
Well, I'm glad to have you, Ben. And you know, I was just sitting there thinking as you were talking. You know, there's a saying that says 11 o'clock a.m. on Sunday morning traditionally has been one of the most segregated hours in America.
Yeah.
But yet we're talking, you know, collectively that, you know, that's hasn't always been true since you've been pastor at Howard Memorial and me pastor at Eastern Star. But Ben, what are some intentional ways we can continue to make sure that we build and grow, you know, intentionally?
Right.
I keep using that word. Because I think the reality is, Ben, a lot of the issues that we have as races, that we have as a society in general, it really begins with something as simple as conversations and talking intentionally, reaching out to those that look different than we are.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, in terms of intentional things, I went back, you and I talked yesterday about what we would talk about tonight, and that classic, really hard to hear, but really challenging and important quote from MLK, you know, that the 11 o'clock hour is the most segregated hour in America on Sunday mornings. And I didn't know this, but originally he spoke that on Meet the Press.
Mm-hmm.
He's talking to the nation, right? This was not just a conversation for pastors. This is a conversation for us as a nation. And it's race and racism is something that the church is not the only one experiencing. It's
sure.
the world, as we can see out on the streets with the protests. But what I keep thinking about is why it is so hard to break that segregation, or that segregated piece, is because for you all and your people, Sunday morning worship at Eastern Star Missionary Baptist grounds their week, I would imagine. It may even ground their lives, you know, to go even farther. And I know the same is at Howard Memorial. It is so special, and to break that requires so much, and I wonder if it's necessary to break that, right? Mm-hmm. For us to cease worshiping separately in order for us to worship collectively. But with that said, Christ is constantly challenging us to see more than what's in front of our eyes.
Sure.
And so how do we do that intentionally is the conversation that I want to continue to have. And that maybe that is more than just sending our youth over for confirmation. Maybe it's sending our elders over for a Sunday morning. Maybe it's sending your elders over. Maybe it's worshiping together in a non, you know, sort of territorial mm-hmm. space, right? Mm-hmm. And this is your
sure.
space, that's our space.
Sure.
I think the other piece that has been incredibly important for me over the course of my life, but especially in the last couple of weeks and months, is learning the history of why we are so separate. I mean, I think we understand it somewhat on a socioeconomic level, and it's coming up in culture right
sure.
now. But why? I mean, is church just a safe place? And you don't want to disrupt that and say you got to
sure.
come worship with us because
sure.
people won't come.
They won't.
And for us to say there's no more Howard Memorial, we're just going to join up with Eastern Star. Like you ruin everything that we carried to this point.
Yeah.
So I think going back to the way we started this conversation was we share a church building. That is part of our history. And so we have to remember, like, how do we build on that particular piece that may take generations or a generation for us to continuously build? But, I mean, Rome wasn't built in a day, to use the terrible cliche.
Sure.
But if we can continuously focus on the fact that there's something that combines us as opposed to something that divides us.
Right.
And right now, race is divisive. But it does. I don't think it needs to be.
No.
Actually, I take that back. I know it doesn't need to be.
Right.
And for the example that we always go back to as pastors, with Christ, he was constantly, he existed with the highest of the high to the lowest of the low. And obviously his concern was always for the poor and the neglected and the outcast and the poverty stricken. But he knew that those in the highest powers needed to be a part of that, right?
For sure.
And so that brings all of our congregations right there together.
For sure.
On both ends of it.
Yeah.
So it's Sunday morning stuff. It's this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you called this, I think you're calling this crucial conversations.
Mm-hmm.
These are crucial conversations not only do we need to have, but, I mean, as much power as our folks think we have as pastors, like,
right.
they're not always listening to us.
I believe that's true.
Mm-hmm. And really what it is us constantly nudging. And I think God is this nudging and sometimes forcefully pushing God who is saying there's more and there's more and you can do more and you can think more and be more.
Yeah.
And the challenge is, though, we as humans love to settle.
We do.
Because it's comfortable.
Right.
I know it. Mm-hmm. I know what I'm going to get. You know, that's why Starbucks and McDonald's are what they are. Like,
for
you
sure.
know exactly what you're going to get when you go in there.
For sure.
And that's why you go back.
Sure.
And they get to know you.
Mm-hmm.
So how does the church sort of both love you and welcome you and make a sanctuary, but also say, we're better
sure.
than this.
Yeah. Ben, I think it all begins with leadership.
Yep.
You know, my exposures, you know, as a young teenager and a young man, I think really shaped the man that I became. Of course, going in the military, being in a very diverse environment, experiencing worship on many different platforms in many different ways has prepared me for what it is that I believe my assignment and my purpose is now.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, for me, it may be a little bit more comfortable, you know, dealing with other faith leaders who don't look like me. But I think the reality is that's not everybody's context and everybody's experience.
Right.
So I think the greatest challenge is being if leaders can model,
mm-hmm.
you know, and set the tone and set the example for these intentional opportunities, I really think we'll have a better chance
right.
in, you know, seeing more diversity, seeing more unity in the body of Christ. But again, we've got to lead by example. And the truth of the matter is, Ben, even if you're, you know, somewhat comfortable with different types of cultures and backgrounds, it's still not an easy lift, is it? It's still not. I mean, because again, you know, even with that, sometimes denomination can get in the way. Sometimes,
oh, yeah.
you know, dogma and doctrine can get in the way. So how do you navigate through that, Ben, when we all don't maybe exactly believe, you know, doctrinally the same things? How can we, I won't say bypass religion,
right.
but how can we bridge that gap between religion and relationship? Let me say it that way.
Okay, that's a good question. And those the dogmatic and the theological, that is gonna we're gonna differ
yeah.
greatly. I guess the gift of that though is to me that proclaims the creativity with which our God created you and
sure.
me and every one of us because we're all made in God's image. So I would celebrate that diversity in the first place. The second place I would say is for us as churches to unite not necessarily around a theological other than lordship of Jesus Christ, but maybe this is, we're going to do this as a model for Tarboro.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, start small. But this is
sure.
our town. This is something that we can invite our people, because it's not going to just be us. If it's
no.
just us, this is futile. It's
sure.
not worth it.
Right.
But if we can model this and do it for the town of Tarboro, and focus on the unity that we're trying to proclaim in Tarboro, and then maybe it gets to Edgecombe County, and then maybe it gets to the tri-counties and moves out. I think that is something that all of us would be willing, and I think the folks who are watching, and my folks and your folks, would feel comfortable unifying around Tarboro as opposed to a theological doctrine. Yeah. And I think, too, there is potential in hearing where those differences might be, mm-hmm. right? And not in the interest of saying, oh, well, that's them and this is us, but saying, huh, that's an interesting and different way to read scripture or to understand culture or to think about things. And I do think it's a lack of it's a fear. It's not a lack, but sometimes it's a fear of, I don't want to say the wrong things. Uh-huh. I don't want someone to be mad at me. But if we begin with this, we're getting together because we want to unify or build up Tarboro as a community, I think the subjects would be relatively safe, to use that language. But then out of that, you can start to dig into, why is it that the African-American experience is this? Mm-hmm. Whereas as a white man, I don't know that.
Sure.
But and to ask questions and to know you're going to say the wrong thing.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah,
you are. I mean, and this is what I like. If you hear one thing, I want you to hear one: God loves you. And two, I really want you to hear that, like, we're all going to make the mistakes.
Sure.
Right. We're going to say the wrong things, but, and this is a humongous but, like, but there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God, and I pray there's nothing that can separate us from the love of one another.
Sure.
And so I do think that there's that, like, sort of fear of jumping off and being like, I'm just going to say the wrong things, or someone's going to be mad, or someone's going to say something that really irritates me. Yep.
It's okay.
Yeah. It is okay.
Yeah.
But that's where I would put a lot of pressure on us as leaders, and not just faith leaders, but leaders in this town, to say, okay, that is a statement, but, like, we're not going to let that statement be the only statement. Like, we're going to keep moving forward. Right, we're not going to let one understanding of race or racism be the story that we tell. I think we all have a story to tell of how we're living through this time. And if we can shed light on that story alongside the story of what God is doing in there, I think it has transformational possibilities.
Same here, Ben. Because at the end of the day, my relationship with Christ is about relationship. It's a personal relationship.
Yep.
And the reality is, you know, I think that is kind of one of the issues that really kind of keep us separated, is because, you know, we sometimes lack the courage to step out and try to build a relationship with someone that we've made all these assumptions about. And when you sit down and start talking to them, you say, man, we got more in common than even what I thought.
Yeah.
And so.
And there's a... There's something, and I wrote a devotion about this recently, of we tend to, you know, it's called, we individualize a community, but then so I would say, oh, Kelly Andrews is an African-American pastor, so he represents all African-American pastors. That's not true.
No.
Right? And on the reverse side, we will say things, if we like the culture or we like the people, whether it's denominations, whether it's race, whether it's sports teams or whatnot, mm-hmm. if we like them and something bad happens, we'll say, oh, that was just an aberration. That was just a one-off. And what it does is it completely flattens our stories, which are rich and way more three-dimensional. But that only happens, we only hear those stories if we're building those relationships.
Sure.
And here's the biggest challenge, I think, is time. Mm-hmm. It takes time to build a relationship.
It does.
You know, God, I would love it if we could just walk up and be like, hey, will you be my best
right.
friend?
Yeah.
Will you tell me your life story?
Sure.
But we're not Christ, and we don't have that ability.
Sure.
However, I do think we have the ability to keep at it.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I mean, Christianity has been around for 2,000 years for a reason.
For
right?
sure.
God's not
for
done
sure.
with us.
I believe it.
And there's something, we're moving towards something.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we swore maybe two steps forward.
right.
But whatever that is, mm-hmm. I guess that would be that we're being nudged forward. And while I would love to be able to answer MLK's question and challenge and say it's not a problem anymore, it still is. But I do think that there's progress, And progress that we have to keep pushing. Mm-hmm. You can never think you've made it.
Sure.
And so I guess I would turn the question around to you. And what do you think is, how do our churches, to take kind of the two that are here, how do we build on the connections that we have?
That's a great question. And I appreciate you kind of keenly, you know, flipping it. But I think the reality being is, I don't know why during this discussion, I'm kind of thinking about Peter in the book of Acts. When he's up on the rooftop waiting for food to be, get, you know, he's hungry and he's on the top of the roof and he has this vision and he sees the sheep coming down with all manner of four-footed beasts and God tells him, arise, kill and eat. And he's like, not so, Lord, you know, like, hey, I don't eat this kind of food,
right.
You know, and God has to have this conversation with him and letting him know that he's going to cause him to have to step out of his comfort zone for sure to do something that he's calling him to do. So God is calling this Jewish apostle into an unknown realm, race, culture of Gentiles. And it's amazing that I can imagine on Peter's journey to Cornelius' house, he's got all these kinds of things going through his mind as it relates to, okay, God, I know this is you. I have no idea of what I'm going to find when I get there, but I know you've mandated and you've called me to do it. And when he gets into the house and he starts ministering, the same thing that he saw on the day of Pentecost amongst all these Jews is the same things he sees amongst these Gentiles. So, and Peter then becomes the advocate saying, hey guys, you know, I know what you may think and I know what our traditions say, and you know, but let me tell you something. God did something in their lives just like he did in our lives. And I really think being in every segment of our society, we need to start I won't say mandating, that's probably not the right word, but maybe like you're saying, encouraging those in leadership to start sharing some realities concerning, you know, the things that we ought to do as far as having conversations and convincing those who may have a different take on, you know, what they thought they knew or what they thought they saw, and saying, hey, okay, I know you feel this way, but let me tell you what God said and what I saw. And I think that kind of lends itself to what Dr. King was trying to tell the white pastors in that regard from the Birmingham jail, that, hey, if we're really going to be united racially and culturally, hey, you guys who have this position of power and influence, you need to understand your role in that. So I think that not only just the pastoral role,
right,
but those who are leaders in society and in various ways, we need to begin to start having you know, conversations in those uncomfortable places, even at the tables of Thanksgiving. And when we hear things, you know, that people say that are not true, we need to call those things out. And sometimes I know that's uncomfortable, but we've got to get comfortable with being uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because if there's change going to happen, if the changes that we know need to happen, they're going to happen because we take the time and the courage to step up and say, and start challenging thoughts that not helping us get to where we need to be.
Yeah. You were talking about that story from Acts about Peter, and then the story about Thanksgiving, you know, bringing it to Thanksgiving. I still think you can break bread with people over that you may completely disagree with.
For sure.
And something happens around the table. I mean, it happened for Christ. It's the reason he instituted communion.
For sure.
And it can happen for us. And I do think that there's table conversations. I love watching, if you watch a dinner conversation or a dinner unfold, I mean most people are sort of stiff at
sure.
the beginning,
oh,
and nervous.
Sure.
And then by the end, you know, it's sort of the lean in and the comfortability. Now, that's not always a good thing.
Oh, for sure, for sure.
But the comfortability to be able to open up and say, wow, we just ate together. And that's not a bad thing. And we can build on this. So maybe in addition to worshiping together, it's eating together.
Mm.
It's the meal aspects. I think those are big. I think it's more. I think worship is the basis.
For sure.
But out of worship, I think there's got to be other things that we start to do. And I know your church is just as mission minded as mine. So maybe it's getting involved with school systems. It's mm-hmm. doing stuff like that where we get to see And I always think about this because I did a lot of youth mission trips. Like, when you do mission work, you're doing something, but it's sort of like getting ready for dinner where you're also talking, and sort of the conversation is a little easier because you're not just staring at each other.
For sure.
And so maybe there's mission work involved in all of this. I think there's more... there's more than jumping straight to that 11 o'clock segregated hour. Not that that's not incredibly important.
Sure.
But maybe we've got to take time to get there.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
I don't know exactly what that looks like.
Sure.
But the fact that you and I are sitting together in the same room and having this conversation, I think is a great start. It's not the beginning. It's not the end.
Yeah.
But it's certainly the beginning.
Sure.
There's something that I've been thinking a lot about lately, and it's a quote from an Eastern Orthodox priest, which is kind of crazy, but in terms of liturgy, and his central question is, what is this life that Christ died for that we might have life? Like, what is it that, what life do we proclaim when we say Jesus Christ died that we might have life?
Mm-hmm.
And I have continuously come back to, it's a life where every life flourishes.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the church has a role to play in that. It's not the only thing the church is not the only responsible party.
Mm-hmm.
You know, government and schools and parents and grandparents and all that. But where does the church proclaim life for everybody?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think that proclamation then needs to happen outside, again, our comfortable space and place. We've got to, you know, share that proclamation wherever we go. And I know we're good at proclaiming it, again, in our spaces, in the places we're the most comfortable. But sometimes, you know, not so much outside of the places where, you know, we're not as familiar. And that's why I think exposure is key, Ben.
Yeah.
Because the reality is, the more exposure we have outside of our own communities, I think it forces us to expand our thinking. It forces us to expand our you know, our viewpoints. It forces us to maybe look at things from a different perspective.
Right.
And I don't think we do as good a job of that as, you know, when we're commanded to go into the hedges and the highways and compel them. You know, I think sometimes that is a challenge for us because the reality of media and just the tone of the outlets, media outlets, it's not very appealing to go into the hedges. And I'm just saying, I think right now people are really fearful, really afraid. And again, I think that's a systematic issue as well. But I really think people are really fearful and afraid simply because of, you know, what they're listening to or what they're looking at. It's causing people to walk in fear more than faith.
Right.
So, but we as people of faith have to understand that even in the midst of the challenges we have, we still believe that God is still greater than all the challenges we have. And we have to step out on faith.
Right.
Our thing this year, Ben, was taking a leap of faith.
Yeah.
And in January, I had no idea that it is literal. I mean, we have taken some tremendous leaps as it relates to how we worship and where we worship and the tools and the resources that we're adding
right.
into worship. I never thought when I was saying these things, and I guess prophesying these things, that I'd be sitting here tonight with you on Facebook Live. I mean, that wasn't in the plan, but I really understood that this 2020 was going to be a year that we would have to get out of our comfort zones. We would have to see things in a different way that we have not seen it. And to be quite honest with you, being in the midst of this crisis, I still see Christ.
Yeah.
I still see him in the middle of everything that's happening. That for me, everything is not doom and gloom. Everything is not, you know, the sky is falling. I see Christ working in the midst of everything that I'm, you know, a part of, even in the midst of our conversations.
Right.
I just think it's just, you know, part of our finest hour is still ahead of us, Ben.
Amen to that. Yeah. I would echo that I feel such hope in the midst of all of this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we were chatting before this started about, you called it the silver linings, right? It's there have been some amazing shifts for us as churches,
mm-hmm.
but also as pastors, and leadership has changed dramatically, right?
For sure.
We can't visit in the same way we visit, but it doesn't mean we can't visit.
True.
We can't worship in the same way we're used to worshiping, but it has certainly not stopped us from worshiping.
Not at all.
And I think our congregants have shifted just as well. But it is that lag, that it seems like this is taking so long, and I know that it's discouraging, and I feel that discouragement, and you are 100% sure, or correct when you say you turn on the news, and it's doom and gloom, right?
It is.
But that is when I'm often, and the challenge right now is it's so hot outside,
for sure.
So you say go get outside, well that's a challenge, but when you go outside, you don't see the same things that you're hearing,
mm-hmm.
right? You see people still getting along. You see people doing, you know, people are still people, so
sure.
You're going to see good and bad. But overall, people have shifted in such beautiful ways.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why, I mean, I wish that we could just have happy news. I mean, right, I know bad news sells, right?
For sure.
I totally get
for
that.
Sure.
But how do we shift away from bad news that sells to news that encourages and lifts up and provides hope? Even in the most mundane ways,
mm-hmm. yeah,
and that's where I mean you we started with the Bebo Norman song, and you referenced that yesterday. That video I put together was more for me than my folks,
mm-hmm.
and for to share was a constant reminder that in the midst of all this, God's hope is nudging up right next to where we are.
For sure.
And when our hope touches what God is doing, transformation happens.
Awesome.
And so for us to see that. And it does. You have to be encouraged. There are some days where it's hard for us
for
sure. to get up and to proclaim that. And that's where the congregations lift us up. And then vice versa. And it's not, you're not always going to be high as a high.
No.
You're going to be having the lows of the low. Right? The 23rd Psalm, right?
Sure.
Yea, though
sure.
I walk through the valley of shadow of death,
yeah,
right?
Sure.
But then you get to go to the mountaintop too,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah, sure.
And so life is, the life of faith is full of that. But if you do it alone, you probably won't make it. But if you do it with Christ, and if you do it with a community of faith, of which Eastern Star and Howard Memorial are, it's a beautiful thing.
It is.
And so it gets back to that, like, so how do we bring our experiences as African-Americans in Tarboro and white folks in Tarboro together so that those experiences build each other up and aren't divisive? Because I think there's such a shared common history. But again, we got to sit around tables and talk about it and find it.
That's right.
And I know some of those times we're going to find some stories that we just don't like.
That's true.
But that's not the only story.
Sure.
And that doesn't mean that we can't be and feel redemption
mm-hmm.
or forgiveness or growth or sort of a movement away from that. Or maybe not away from that, but we can build on that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
When we say what Paul wrote, that you know nothing has separated us from the love of God, we believe in and profess a deep faith in a God who constantly loves us.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't, then we are...
Yeah. yeah. We are done long time ago. Sure.
And God loves them.
For sure.
And if God can love them, then God can certainly love you.
No doubt. God calls them then also to do some mighty things as
right.
well. We start looking at the people in the Bible that God uses,
right.
man, I don't think they would be people that we would select.
Right, we would not put them in our
right,
boards.
Right, but it's amazing, though, that when God sees us, isn't it amazing he doesn't see what we see? And sometimes I don't think, Ben, we take the time that we need to see beyond just the surface or the superficial. We don't explore deeper parts of a person.
Right.
You know, we unfortunately, you know, too often, Ben, we look at what we see and we begin to immediately form, you know, judgments, and we begin to, you know, form ideas of who and what we think we're seeing in a person. But man, we miss it.
Yeah,
we miss it, Ben. And I know, again, people are on edge, but you know, I come from a family of talkers. I mean, when I was a kid, my dad, I don't care where we went, Ben, my dad would always see someone that he knows. And it was so frustrating. That's like, Dad, we got to go. I mean, hey, it's, you know, I mean, you know, we've got to go. But inevitably, he just always found time to have conversations with people. And Ben, it seemed as if you talked long enough, my dad would find some kind of common denominator. He'd probably find someone that he knew or somehow it seems everybody he talked to had that he left with some connection. And Ben, and you know, I grew up to some degree resenting that
yeah.
because again, it always, you know, seemed to, you know, make us wait for whatever we had to do. But the reality is, Ben, I gleaned that from my father. I took that away. I am now him. Dad, hey, Dad. I'm now a product of watching him just sit down with people and talk to people and make them feel, you know, as if they are the most important thing in that moment. They weren't just, you know, he wasn't the kind to just say, you know, to say something and, you know, how's the weather? He really took time to go beyond just, again, the superficial. And Ben, I really believe conversation and actually having conversations is a lost art.
Yeah.
I really believe it's ironic that we call these mediums social media. And I think we're probably less social than we've ever been.
Amen.
I just really believe that kids are more isolated now than they've ever been.
Right.
That there are not opportunities now where the whole families in some homes, you know, sit down and talk about what's going on during the course of the day. You know, it's a different world, Ben. And I think that is also why we find ourselves in, you know, so much chaos, is because we've gotten away from the basic things that's kind of made us who we are.
Yeah, getting back to you talking about around the sitting around the table is not a normal thing.
Sure.
As it used to be, but it has such powerful effects, mm-hmm. and affects us in such a way that we know we're loved. We know someone cares enough to ask how our day was.
Sure.
And we also learn about people. I mean, you probably learned a lot about your dad.
I did.
In those conversations, even though you were annoyed beyond belief.
Sure.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
But you learned more about your dad and how his connection to that man or to that woman or to that person. Like, you're like, whoa, my dad is more than my dad.
For sure.
Because I listened to those conversations. And I do think when you converse with somebody, you see them on a deeper level than what you thought they were, or the one comment you've heard about them, or mm-hmm. the one comment you've heard them say.
Great point.
The person starts to become a richer, fuller person of, wow, that's not who I thought that was.
Mm-hmm.
I always thought that so-and-so was so-and-so, which is again, where when you look at the stories from Christ, he's constantly trying to get to know people.
Constantly.
And he's constantly, this was pointed out to me, Reese, he's constantly going to or coming from a meal. Mm-hmm. The guy ate all the time,
right?
Which is great.
Yeah,
I mean, more power
sure.
to him.
Yeah.
But he knew that was a space where meals were so important in that culture. And they're certainly still important in our culture today.
For sure.
And it's around those tables that you start to learn. Mm-hmm. And you grow as
for
much
sure.
as you others grow around the table too. And
sure.
maybe that's another space when... connection point for truth. When we're able to gather back
sure,
together.
For sure. For sure.
And that I think is another piece of this pandemic that is a challenge, is we can't gather in the same ways that we're used to.
For sure.
Yeah. But I think another piece that I think is important is that piece about your pointing to your phone about social media and the isolation that we feel because of it is something we have to attend to
mm-hmm.
as a church and mm-hmm. to say, I don't know what we have to say other than to say that it's a problem that we have to address.
For sure.
Right? We think the phone will help us with everything, but there's always there's a blind side to everything, and do we pay attention to the curse that comes with technology?
Right. For sure. For
right?
sure. And I think it's kind of subtle, Ben, because the reality is, you know, the technology is only as good as the person that's holding it in their hands or, you know, operating the device, the reality
right.
is. And while you were talking, it just made me think when you said Christ was either going or coming from a meal. I just want our viewers to kind of be mindful of this fact too, Ben, is that in Revelation 3:20, Jesus he's standing at the door and knocking.
Yeah.
And he says, if you let me in, if you can hear my voice. And sometimes I think we live in a very loud culture. We don't. Some people can't even sleep if they don't have, you know, some device on or some music on. They have a problem. You know, I mean, life can be pretty noisy.
Right.
But I believe, Ben, now this is Kelly Andrews' theology. You won't find this in the Bible. But I really am of the opinion that when it comes to hope and faith, hope is really not loud.
Mm.
I think it's amazing that when God is talking to Elijah, you know, here comes an earthquake, here comes all of these elements and all wind and all of these elements, but God is speaking in a still small voice. And I really believe that sometimes The reality of being is, it's not that the God is not speaking.
Right.
The reality is we just can't hear what he's saying.
Right.
So that's what I think Christ is saying when he's knocking on the door. If any man hears my voice, if they have enough inward discernment and perception that number one, it's me knocking. Number two, that it's me speaking.
Right.
The thing is, all you have to do is just open the door.
Right.
And if you open up, he says, I'm going to come in. And here we're right back at you and sup with you. I will sit at your table. I will take time to personally have an experience with you.
Yeah.
And I really believe in my heart, Ben, there's somebody who feels alone. There's somebody who feels, you know, this is the worst time in your life. You feel that there's one thing happening after another thing after another thing. But I want to let you know that Christ is speaking. He may be standing at the door of your heart and knocking. And all he wants you to do is hear his voice and let him in. And if you let him in, he will come in. And he will have fellowship with you at your table. At your table. And he's not going to be picky about what it is that you set before him. You know, he's not. He's not. Because the reality is, he wants to have a relationship with you. And even if he's already at the table, he wants to have a deeper relationship with you than even that you have now. And maybe you're feeling some separation and isolation and anxiety. But at the end of the day, I really want you to know that he's still speaking. He's still knocking. He still desires us to open. And Ben, I think sometimes we don't open all the way. We kind of crack the door,
yeah,
and we want to kind of see. But the reality is, you know, we have to be open with being more open. And I think you can't do that. Ben, we cannot have conversations if, you know, you're doing all the talking and I'm doing all the listening. It's got to be an exchange there. It has to be reciprocity.
Right.
I can't just be sitting here just waiting for you to finish what it is that you're saying. That's not how it works. I got to listen and I got to internalize
right.
it and then maybe share my views on it.
Yeah.
I think that's what it is. I think most of what conversation is, Ben, is listening. It's not talking.
Right. Well, I would say this too, in terms of going back to how do we begin this conversation about joining our churches together and doing things together. That was where I think it's got to be worship and
mm-hmm.
something else. It's a both and, because the way we worship is a beautiful way that both of our congregations worship, but it is a lot more of one or two or multiple people speaking and a group of people listening.
For sure.
Similar to what we're doing right now.
Right.
But if that's the only space and place that we get together, then that cross-pollination, that the ability for our folks to sit in a pew and to look at each other and to talk, you need those spaces too for that relationship to happen, for that conversation to happen. So like you said, you can internalize and you can hear and you can learn people's names. You can begin to learn their story. I mean, you know, this is kind of the joke that I always joke about. You can't say anything bad about anybody in Tarver because they're all related to each other, right?
Right.
But to hear that and to suddenly hear like, oh, so-and-so is related to so-and-so and went to school with people, like these connections start to become realer and deeper. And it's not just those folks. It's these are my people
mm-hmm.
now. And that has to happen with worship and meals. It has to happen with worship and Bible studies. It has to happen with worship and other things. And so how do we bridge that gap? And I mean, the crazy part too, and I keep looking out on the street, like bridging the gap, we're no more than, what, 4 or 5 blocks from each other?
That's right?
I mean, the gap is not huge.
It's not huge. It's not a stretch.
So how do we do that? And maybe there are opportunities for Bible studies when the pandemic is over, and opportunities for our groups to get together and to build on that.
Mm-hmm.
I certainly think that was what MLK was pushing for when he made that challenge to say a fact that the 11 o'clock hour is the most segregated hour. He never said it has to stay the most segregated hour. He merely pointed out and made a statement to say, which he was so good at making these statements of saying, this is how it is.
Sure.
You can choose to not pay attention to that, but this is still how it is. And that's what you and I talked about this yesterday with the letter from the Birmingham jail. I'm in jail and you're not, and you guys have an opportunity to use your power, right? You have a power that I don't. And that's, as white pastors, that's something that still strikes us, or I pray it strikes us. And so that's something for it to, he was constantly nudging and in a beautiful way. And
sure.
Man.
Sure.
So.
And Ben, I still think, you know, there's a way to challenge and be persistent without being, you know, overbearing or obtuse. There's a way you can do it. But again, I keep saying there's an art to it. There really is. And I think we do well to maybe really consider not only what we say, but how we say it.
Yes.
You know, because I know a lot of times, you know, I make a living, with my mouth. And there's more than one or two times that I put my foot in it. But at the same time, that doesn't stop me from, continuing to try to build and learn and grow from conversations that are hard to have.
Yeah.
Or Ben, be honest enough or courageous enough that when I say or do something that may offend someone, to say I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Or to say I didn't mean it that way. Or ask for forgiveness. And I think those kinds of things all go into making us more united.
Yes.
You know, it's and making us more the society I think that we can be. Because
right.
I think our potential is endless.
Oh, yeah.
But the reality is I think the challenge is sometimes so massive that, you know, we kind of get overwhelmed. But I think it's the little things like this, a 30 to 45 minute conversation. Who knows what this conversation, might be a springboard for.
Right.
We have no idea of where this conversation may take us. And we may be able to look back in just a, small amount of time and say, well, I can remember that we had that 45 minute conversation, and now look at, what we're able to do and how far things have gone because, we took the time to pick up the phone and say, hey, Ben, can you come?
Right.
And just have a conversation. I guess in closing, I wanted to kind of maybe understand why was this so important for you there's a lot of things you could be doing at home. What was it about? Because it seems like almost when I called, you were like saying yes before I even really extended the invitation. What was it about it, Ben, that you just felt it was, I don't know, because again, at the end of the day, I didn't know what you'd say, but what was it that, you didn't have to, I didn't have to take 24 hours for you to give me an answer?
Yeah.
You seemed like you were ready for what it was that I was saying.
Well, for multiple reasons. I mean, what's going on in the world, and what's going on in America, but it's spread to the world.
Yeah.
Ever since the killing of George Floyd.
Yeah.
Is that the conversations have in the most positive way erupted onto the streets and into the churches and into the halls of power, whereby people are now realizing that we haven't had conversations that we should have had. And the challenge that we're right now is we don't know how. Your point was eloquent earlier of you can have a conversation, but you can be obtuse and say the wrong things and come on too strong or pushy and that stuff. What we're realizing is I don't know that we know how to have conversations, the lost art of conversation. So how do we as pastors model something? Because I do think that the Christian pastor has this ability to build up. We also have this powerful ability to break down and destroy, which we see more often than I wish we do. Mm-hmm. But I'm having it on my heart of how do I have these conversations, not just with my congregation which is predominantly white, but across racial boundaries and racial divides and whatnot. And then, and I've had sort of side conversations, but having this, I pray it's a model for other folks to do it and also an encouragement. So when you called, it was the same as, Peter waiting for the food. And it was as if when you called and said, I want to have this conversation. Yes, I was all in because the truth of the matter is, as much as I say others need to have this conversation, I need to have this conversation. Wow. And it's got to start with myself, and it's got to, continuously build. And it can't be a conversation.
No.
It has to be multiple conversations that probably never end. Mm-hmm. I don't think that we're going to just eradicate racism. I don't think we're going to eradicate all of the issues that are out in the world. But if we're cognizant of the fact that they're out there, and if we're aware of the fact that the Christian faith speaks very positively to that, to mm-hmm. say, the redemption piece, the forgiveness piece, the grace piece,
for sure.
And not that you have to be a certain piece in order to be something. God wants us, no matter where we are, no matter what we're doing, no matter what state we think we're in, and wants to build us up from that, not once we get the education and we're, you know, as understanding and aware as we are. So your phone call came at a time where I've been trying to figure out how it is you have, and I personally have this conversation. So again, that's why I'm grateful that we as both men of faith, we as both pastors of churches in Tarboro, but we as people that are of different cultural and racial backgrounds, I think is huge. Mm-hmm. And I hope says something.
Yeah. Me too, Ben. The reality is, in the last, I'd say 18 to 24 months, I've had a lot of life-changing events, and have had some conversations with those relationships that I had in those times. They were, some of them were fractured, some of them were strained, and it's kind of, you know, difficult over time. To, you know, allow relationships that you spent so much time building, you know, I think there comes a point in your time, in your life where you say, you know, you got to stop waiting for them to call you. You got to call them and say, hey, you know, the reality is, you know, I know time has passed, but at the same time, this relationship means enough for me to step outside of my comfort zone and reach out to try to mend whatever fence may be broken.
Right.
And I think many of us sometimes wait for someone else to start the to start the path to the conversation, but sometimes the reality is we need to do it ourselves.
Yeah.
And it's not easy to do. I think it requires a certain amount of humility to be able to say that, you know I had a part in playing for us to be where we are.
Right.
So I think the reality is, then I also play a part in the solution.
Yes, amen.
And Ben, I really believe with all the things that are going on in our society and our culture, I think in each of us lies a part of the solution. I don't know if we'll ever have a time where we see the great leaders from our past. I really believe this is a time, Ben, in our history for the leader that we're looking for, that I think a little bit of it lies in all of us. And that's you as well, but you've got to be courageous enough to step outside of your comfort zone and even provide or even be faced with some level of vulnerability. But it takes courage, I think, in this time to be and have the conversations that need to be had, even when they're hard.
Yeah.
And so I hope and pray that, Ben, that first of all, let me say thank you for coming and having this conversation. And again, you've been listening to Crucial Conversations at the Eastern Star Missionary Baptist Church in Tarboro. And I want to thank Ben Kane, pastor of the Howard Memorial Presbyterian Church, a few blocks away, for coming and having a conversation with us. And we hope and pray that the conversations that you need to begin to have, hopefully we've modeled in some shape, way, or form on how you can begin to have those crucial conversations. I pray you have a blessed night, and prayerfully we'll see you again on next week. God bless you.
Amen.